How are you guys doing this morning?
Great.
Doing fantastic.
Well, here's the good news. I got my coffee.
Yeah.
I had temporarily misplaced it earlier this morning, and our electric guitarist was lucky enough to find it for me, so big thanks to Brett. I did not know where I put it. It was a phantom in this room. But that is neither here nor it is there. So I have our first slide up here. I want to review a couple of things we've been talking about. We've been talking about being a disciple, and a disciple has four things we talked about 2 weeks ago. We talked about a disciple believes in Jesus' teaching, and there's an investment of time, and there's a return of learning. So if you believe in something, and really in Jesus' teachings, you're like, hey, if I believe it, I want to learn more about it. And we talk about Netflix binge watching. It's like, you like a show on Netflix, you're going to watch more of it. If you believe in Jesus' teaching, you're going to want more of it. You're going to want to invest time, and your return is learning from that. A disciple rests on Jesus' sacrifice. And this one, hope from the reality of the resurrection. We talked about how, you know what? The Bible is not just a book that stays, the words just like stay on the page. It's not like this piece of paper where it's like, oh, you can read this, but it really doesn't move yet. Maybe it does, but they're really just my sermon notes. So I don't know. But when we read about Jesus, we read in the Bible, those words seem to jump off the page not because of how they're written and wow, this guy's so articulate, but because of the reality of the resurrection. It happened 2,000 years ago, but it still is real and affects us and changes us today. Number three, a disciple imbibes his spirit. We're talking about this word imbibe, which is like a funky, crazy word that in most contexts has to do with something else. But we talked about how imbibe, especially from a plant standpoint and like a plant's seed, imbibes water, which means it takes in water in ultra microscopic spaces, which is cool because usually I think like a definition would have the word microscopic, but this had ultra microscopic, which just shoots me off the rails. It's wonderful. Ultra microscopic places in our heart is where a disciple drinks in God's spirit. And then number four, imitates his example. So we said, learns his teaching and his actions. If you read about Jesus in the Bible, which I'm hoping if you haven't already, we're going to keep doing that during these teachings. We have Bible studies here, and we have a wonderful TNT program on Tuesday nights. We have a great Sunday school program, and an adult Bible study on Sunday mornings. We have a lot of ways that you can read about Jesus. And you know what? We have a lot of things that Jesus said, and we have a lot of things in the Bible that record what Jesus did, his actions. And so a disciple imitates his example. Not only just learns what he said, but learns what he did and is an imitator. We talked about that Eminem song with the real Slim Shady, please stand up, and all in the music video, which don't watch it, it's inappropriate. But all these people that look exactly the same, they're coming out on a conveyor belt, and they're all standing up, and Slim Shady's just like, we're gonna have a problem here. Because everybody's imitating, everybody's trying to follow somebody's example, and we don't want to be Slim Shady, but we want to imitate Jesus' example. On the next slide, this is what we talked about last week. This, which if you weren't here last week, this probably looks like really confusing. You're like, is that math? Like, what is that? But we talked about the difference between justification and sanctification, which as Lutherans is actually pretty important for us, because we take theology pretty seriously here, not because we just want to be smart and haughty and up there, just, you guys don't know much. But you can laugh, it's a giggle moment. Justification and sanctification, it's a good way for us to remember that Jesus has already saved us. We cannot modify God's love for us. We can't get any closer to heaven through anything that we do. There's nothing that we can do to get us closer to being justified because that is entirely God's work. And the way I kind of reminded us of it, justification starts with what letter?
J.
Yeah, and whose name starts with a J?
Jesus.
Jesus. Yes, Jesus does the justification. And then, so we got Father, you know, God the Father, and then Jesus, and then the Holy Spirit. Sanctification also starts with an S. So that is the Spirit's work in our hearts. That's part of that ultra-microscopic imbibing of the Spirit. And so at the moment that the Spirit comes into our hearts and says, whoa, holy cow, I can now say, I believe in Jesus. At that exact moment, we are both 100% justified, completely saved, eternally, and then starts that sanctification process, which is this lower chart that you see here. Sanctification is all these good works that we do as a Christian that get us nowhere closer to heaven. But because we believe in Jesus, because we want to imitate his example, because of those four disciple things that we just talked about, we want and we're called by God to do these things. So we might have some good days. That's when the chart goes up. And then we might slip into some sin. That's where the chart goes down. And then we might have some good days where we do some good things. Maybe we help out at the Genesis food pantry where they serve homeless folks every single day, which is really great. Oh man, the Spirit, Holy Spirit, worked in my heart to go help some people today. Or maybe we saw somebody standing on the road with a sign that says, please help, I don't have any food. And we stopped and we gave them food or we gave them money. Or we followed them to the gas station and filled their tank up with gas. Whatever it is, the Spirit is, that's who's working in our hearts when we're doing that. But then sometimes we fall into our sinful nature and we get a little downtrend. Maybe we wake up, you know, and we're going through a season where we feel far from God. Maybe you've been there. This is all part of that sanctification process, and we trust that one, justification, completely done. That if we were to die at any single moment along this path, past that little cross thing with the two circles, that we would be in heaven. 100%, 100% true, 100% trust that. And while we are still here on earth, God calls us to do his work, which is that sanctification process. And then, next slide. Yeah, last week we talked about this acronym, YET. You're eligible too. And we talked about the disciples and how screwy they were. I mean, they were just messed up people. And they were arrogant. What?
Kind of like us.
Exactly like us. And so we talked about how we are eligible to be arrogant and haughty and inconsiderate and shooing away children from Jesus, like disciples. What got into them? We are eligible for that. Yet, we are also eligible to be his disciples in the ways that they shine, especially after Jesus ascended into heaven, and all of a sudden they started an entire church that ended up being millions, if not billions, of people, billions of souls that were affected by the message of their teacher, our Savior, their Savior too. Jesus. We are eligible to do some of the same things that they did, which, I mean, maybe for us seem like, oh, that's out of my reach. I don't have the talents, the abilities, the time, etc., 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 to do those things. But last week we talked about you are eligible for those things. You are called to be disciples. And so this week, we're getting more towards the rubber meets the road part of things. So today we'll talk about discipling and, I skipped a very important part of my notes. It says the two main outward tasks of a disciple. So the inward tasks, we already talked about those. Those are four points. A disciple is this, 1, 2, 3, 4, imbibed the Spirit. That's the one that just sticks out in my head. But those four things that we went over, there are two outward tasks of a disciple. And you'll notice this as you know, if you read through anything about the disciples after Jesus went up to heaven, is you'll notice that they do these two things almost exclusively. I mean, I'm surprised they had time to eat because they were so busy doing these things. One is discipling, and two is evangelizing. Discipling and evangelizing. Next week we'll talk about evangelizing. Might seem kind of scary, but definitely come back because it's going to be a good one. And today we're going to talk about discipling. Discipling is, I think, in the scope of the church, it's an inward task. It's something that we, as we're called to be disciples, we're doing to people who already know Jesus, who already are trying to follow Jesus. What I mean by that is when, so we're already following Jesus. In Matthew 28, and here's where it's just put on your seatbelts, okay? Buckle up, because it's going to get fun. Matthew 28, some of Jesus' last words to his disciples were this, which is kind of the focus of our study today. He says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." There are four important verbs in that passage that I want us to pay attention to. We got this up here already. Can we turn that black for like five seconds?
Okay.
What are the four? I'll read it again, and I want you to pick out the four important verbs for us. "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." What were some of the verbs that you picked out? This is kind of getting into English. Go.
Baptizing.
Teaching. There's one more.
Obey.
No.
Given?
Oh, no.
Therefore, go and make disciples.
Go.
Go. Make. We got make. All right. Go, make, teaching, and baptizing. Actually, baptizing, then teaching. So those are the important verbs that we're going to be going over. The tense of these verbs is important, so let's get that chart up there now. Thank you, Sam. Awesome. Wow. You guys remember this from English class back in, I don't know if you ever got this in English. I don't know if I ever got this in English. I only really learned verb tenses because of French. I took French, and that's why, like, hey, by the way, you can't say I are in French. Like, you have to conjugate the verb. And we have tenses for that, too. So, Mike's like, no, I don't
that
want
was years ago.
Present and future and perfect continuous. So we got some verb tenses here, and we're going to look at the verb tenses because it's important, and it helps us focus in on what we're going to talk about. Notice that go and make are what verb tense? Simple? Present. Yes. And actually, this isn't up there. This is a bonus. They're imperative. It's like a command. We could have just ended that sentence at "therefore go and make." I mean, we'd be like, well, "What should we go? Where should we go? And what should we make?" But really, that is not an incomplete sentence. You can say "go." You say "make." You just do that. That's kind of the cool part of verbs is you can just say them in the imperative form. And it's a command. And so Jesus says, "Therefore, go and make." So that is his imperative. And he's like, and so he kind of anticipates the disciples and says, so instead of just leaving it as go and make, he says, oh, yeah, go and make disciples. So that's what we're going and making them. Making them into, go and make disciples of all nations. So there we have where we're going and what we're making. And then the disciples are probably going to ask, well, how do we do that? And he says, well, baptizing them and teaching them. And what verb tense is baptizing and teaching?
Past.
Present continuous. Just take the "am." I mean, I eating pizza, that doesn't make any sense. But if you look at it this way, we can't just, you can't take out the first part of that sentence. You can't say, you can't take out the verb, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, because it would just be baptizing them and teaching them. That's not a sentence. I are no good to that. But yeah, we have to have, if we're going to throw verbs in there that are continuous present, we have to have something that they're pointing to. Okay, so, because there is no am, there is no state of being, there's no to be verb in there. That's how we can get away with that. So, fun fact, they're the gerund form. If you put an ing on something, it's the gerund. Anyhow, such a nerd sometimes. They're in the present continuous form, meaning that Jesus is commanding them to do these things continuously. There's no start and stop. He's saying, therefore, go and make disciples, baptizing and teaching them. And it's continuous. There's no stop. There's no end point, which kind of seems like, oh man, this is going to go on forever. I'm teaching you right now. It's continuous. I hope you don't have anything to do. You guys are all laughing because you're like, I have something to do. 11:45. Football game's on. Can't use that excuse now. Think about it.
Baseball.
Yeah.
Baseball.
Oh, I thought you said Facebook. I'm like, that will be there later. think about it like this. How would you read the sentence if go and make word part, you know, baptizing all nations? That's not a sentence. Just doesn't make sense, doesn't sound right. So really what Jesus is saying, the chief words are go and make. He's saying, first off, go get them. Go make them. That's that imperative again. And then he's anticipating their question, like, how do we do that? Go baptize. Keep baptizing people. Keep teaching people. Our work here is really never done. And Pastor Mark has actually said this before. I've heard him say it several times in different sermons. In the church, people keep working for God. We do not really experience retirement. And I mean, that is excluding church workers because we retire. No. Volunteers, anybody who wants to be a disciple. The disciples did not like retire from discipling and get a nice discipleship pension and then go live on the island of Patmos. No, John lived there because he was exiled there. Okay? That was not a vacation home. Disciples don't retire. He says there's no retirement. It's really just repositioning. Our retirement as Christians, and we believe this, is upstairs. Not like literally above the false ceiling. It's in heaven. That is our retirement, and that's going to be better than any retirement you could ever experience here on earth. And so that's why I pointed out that this is continuous. This verb tense is continuous. We baptize, we teach continuously. We are teachers. We are baptizers. We are teaching and we are baptizing. And so let's talk about teaching. What should we teach people that would make them into a disciple? This is an open question. I want to see maybe like two hands, two responses on here. What should we be teaching people that would make them a disciple?
God's word.
Think God's word? Anything specific? Or mostly out of Nehemiah? That actually is a really good book. What specifically?
Matthew, Mark, Luke, John.
Okay.
John specifically, I would start.
So the gospel account of like when we have Jesus written about, Nancy, what would you think?
Why I love God.
Okay, so why you love God?
Who is he? You know, because so often in evangelizing, we start with, well, you should be, you know, commit yourself to him. Who is he? Mm-hmm. You know? This
kind of
is
that answer to the
marriage.
Why question?
Yes.
Yeah.
What is so loving about you?
Yeah, why Why should I believe him?
Why should I believe him?
Yeah. So we got. I think, and I think those are both of the majority of what I'm aiming at here is it's teaching the stuff and the why behind the stuff. Another question that I there's no right or wrong answer to. Who was an extremely impactful follower of Jesus in your life, and what did he or she do that made such a difference? Who has made an impact in your life for Jesus, and what did they do that made such an impact?
They lived with dignity in the middle of the struggle.
Okay.
They lived with hope.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very interesting to see.
Trying to figure out, like,
hope,
how do they do that?
In the middle of chaos.
Yeah.
So they're walking through a storm, and it's like, I want that.
Mm-hmm. And they probably had every excuse to be angry, bitter, confused, lazy, apathetic, but instead, mm-hmm. they probably put a lot of hope and strength through that, right?
Bonnie is the person that I would go with that.
Mm-hmm. And what does she do that makes a difference for you?
Well, you know, she doesn't just go to church, she lives it.
Mm-hmm.
To me, you know, I've only really known my hypocritical people mm-hmm. in church, so
yeah.
Bonnie was one of the first people that I met that really seemed to believe it
mm-hmm.
and loved it.
I had a good example in my life. My aunt, I can't say my parents, although they were tried to be good parents, they were not good examples. But my aunt was a lady who went to church and lived it, and she really exemplified, you know, Christ to me. You know, someone who walks the earth and lives.
Even though there were several people in my life, those points of light along the path that exhibited what I was talking about, it was really the fellowship of believers that brought me in.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that...
The community.
Yeah, because so much of our culture tells us to stand alone, stand strong by yourself. Maybe not the millennial generation as much as mine was, but, we're supposed to be selfish.
Independence,
right. Mm-hmm. You know, self-actualization, all that more.
Yep.
That, you know, I knew it didn't work, but it wasn't until I saw people that really cared for each other and was so different than what I saw. They were so countercultural because they were caring and loving each other in an authentic way, not the hypocritical to be seen way that was so dramatically different. That was really the invitation into
mm-hmm.
that.
And if you haven't experienced somebody like that, I really hope that at some point, really soon, you see that. Somebody who just makes a difference because they have Jesus, and they know Jesus, and they live. What I'm hearing is this word living it out, living Jesus. And I had somebody in my life like that. I've had several people like that. But when I was a wee little lad, many moons ago, when we had cassette tapes and VHS, yeah, this is back carbon and stone tablets. No, not that. I had somebody like that in my life, and his name is Scott, he's actually a DCE in Illinois still. But I was like, man, he lives it. He had this like green, kind of creepy looking puppet. But like, oh man, this puppet was so happy. I would just love going up to children's messages when he would have that puppet. And just the way that Scott lived his life and lived his career and just cared about other people, especially about kids. It just showed Jesus. He lived Jesus into my life. And he is a large reason why I'm standing here today. Instead of somewhere else, doing something else in a different career field. He's one of the reasons that I am a director of Christian education today. It's because he lived Jesus, and he was an ECE, and I'm like, I want to be like that. And so there's two things that I want to close with. It'll kind of be a long closing, but we'll close with it. A disciple is finally prepared, and this is the big point of my message today. A disciple is finally prepared when he desires to pursue God on his own, and he multiplies. A disciple is finally, I think, fully a disciple when he desires, or she desires, to pursue God on his own, or her own, and she multiplies, or he multiplies. Great. When we look at the Bible, we read about the disciples, we read about what Jesus taught about, every intention of what he was saying wasn't so that his message would end with the people hearing it. Every intention, everything that Jesus said, it was not just for the people that heard it. It was to go on and on and on and on through people multiplying and multiplying both the message and their imitation and example of Jesus. And so, actually, I have like another story, but it's already a little bit long. I'll give you like the abbreviated version of it. There are two bodies of water around kind of where Jesus grew up and did a lot of his ministry. There's the Sea of Galilee, which is a freshwater kind of lake sea thing. And then there's the Dead Sea, which is a saltwater lake or sea. Yes. They're both seas, kind of lake seas. I don't know what the difference is. There's very extremely distinct differences between the two bodies of water, even though they're only like 50 miles apart, something like that.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's not even that far.
It's just a few miles apart, but the difference between these two bodies of water is night and day, just completely drastic differences. And the main difference is the Sea of Galilee is full of life, and it is a life-giving body of water. It has water flowing into it from the River Jordan, from the north. And then it has water flowing out of it to the south, also into the River Jordan. The Jordan goes like right through it. But it's always filled with water, and it's always supporting tons of fish, tons of plants around it, tons of plants in it, just sea life and life around the area. It supports the human life around it. And then it flows out into the Sea of, or into the Jordan River, and the Jordan River takes it down to the Dead Sea. And the Dead Sea is aptly named. It's perfectly named because it is dead. It is so full of salt, it is so full of toxicity that nothing lives in it, and very few things live around. And as disciples, we are called to be the Sea of Galilee. I don't mean try and turn yourself into a lake, because that would be ridiculous and look silly. Make a Facebook video challenge out of it. It'll catch on. But we're called to be the Sea of Galilee, where we have people feeding into us, and we are being fed by the Spirit, and we are learning and imitating Jesus' example, and then we're pouring out the other end. And we're multiplying onto other people. Just like Jesus' message wasn't meant to end with me. If I read it in the Bible, it's not meant to end with me. It's meant so I can multiply to other people. Just like the Sea of Galilee, it's got water pouring into it, it's got life pouring into it, and it's got life pouring out of it. That's what we're called to be as disciples. That's what we're called to be. So the last slide here, I've got this really cool... isn't that cool? Doesn't it look nice? I can't even take credit for it. I didn't make this. But it is just so awesome. I have these as cards that you will not get today because there's a backside to it that we'll talk about next week. But we've got five actions of a disciple. And this is our discipleship strategy. You got five actions. You pray. You intercede as a disciple. You pray for people. For God to bring you names and say, hey, God, who should I multiply onto? Who should I pour into? You identify, and on this card, it's got three disciples. And if you look at Jesus' life, he had three disciples that were like his like close buddies, Peter, James, and John. And so that's kind of biblical to have three disciples there. It also just focuses in on pouring into three specific people, and we pray about who those people are going to be. The third action is invest in them. Learn who they are. Be vulnerable with them. Share with them. Be a part of their life. Number four is invite them to participate in this process that you're doing. So there we start seeing, wow, this is completely multiplying. Because by step five, the fifth action, it's involved them in this same process. So you say, hey, by the way, you're my three. Here's step one. And imagine you walk them through their five actions. By step five, they've got three more people that they're like, hey, you're my three. Here's step one. This is an example of what a multiplying disciple does. He desires to pursue God on his own. There's no like outward motivation. There's inward. There's, wow, my heart just wants me to learn more and to be more involved and to pour life out instead of just hoarding it all for myself and becoming this dead sea. But instead, I think that God has called me to share it and pour life out. We can see this, and we'll talk more about this, and we'll talk more about it in a different light. I can't even, it's going to be exciting next week. But we're going to talk about this in a different light. It's got a different color, just to differentiate in your mind. But we're going to talk about this more next week, and I'm going to close this in prayer right now, and then we're going to pass the offering plates and have a little bit more prayer, and then we'll close with another song. I want to leave you with this in mind. A disciple multiplies. A disciple pursues God on his own. A disciple pursues God on his own. Studies the word without having somebody like have to nag him or even just remind her. Disciple wants this, and a disciple multiplies. So let's pray real quick, and then we'll pass the offering plate. So if you'd pray with me, Heavenly Father, we know we're called to be disciples. We believe that Jesus did what he did. He died on Good Friday. He rose on Easter morning to conquer our sin. He lived this perfect life, and he gives us an incredible example. Lord, help us to learn that example. Help us to learn what he said, what he did, and to imitate that, and then to not stop it at us, God. We want to multiply it onto other people. We want that flowing water of life to flow out of us as well into other people around us. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Okay.